How's everybody doing with their trials and tests and temptations? We're right on the brink right now, and we're going to get these temptations, no question about it. I'm aware of this. Other people are, myself, others are getting tempted to, oh, let's go back and listen to the voice of continuity fear of the flesh. The voice of the continuity fear is the flesh. And so how's everybody doing with that? So far, so good here. And now, where are we at? Where are we at? We're at the end of the age, end of the world cycle, which doesn't mean the planet's going to disappear or blow up or anything like that, necessarily, no. The end of the world, it really refers to the end of this age, end of this cycle. And with an ending, it can't really end unless another one begins, actually. So, a new world is being born, and it will officially, you could say it officially gets underway on the 23rd of September. This is the end of the old and the beginning of the new, because at that point there will be this, what it basically is, for those who understand this, it would be pretty clear that the President of the United States is in Revelation is the first beast, and the Pope is the second beast. And the purpose of the second beast is to popularize the first beast and tell the whole world, hey, you know, this first beast is really great, he's wonderful, he's going to really solve all our problems. And see, the second beast has a lot of goodwill, tremendous amount of goodwill, and people really listen to them. So the second beast is the one who runs cover for the first beast, because otherwise, without the second beast running cover for the first beast would not be able to be get power over the world. And there's not anyone even remotely close to these two in terms of filling those roles. And what they're really going to do is decide on a basic agenda for the new world order, or the, how are we going to order the new world? It's that simple. And they're going to decide one, you know, change in financial system, massive change financial system, and massive, you know, efforts, well, new world, one world religion, massive efforts towards a single global religion, and, you know, those are two of the most fundamental, the financial structure, the economic structure, and the religious structure of the order of the new world. How is the new world going to be ordered? And they are absolutely the two beasts. Those are the ones who are totally focused on this, how to order the new world. And they have very, very strong agendas. And they're going to get together. They're going to see, hey, our agendas are pretty much the same. We see eye to eye in how to order the new world. And so they will support one another and give one another credence, right? This is how it works. We're being double teamed. Which is fine. Okay, keep in mind that all of us have perfect standing in God. We can never lose that. We can never do anything on all our pretension that we're not in good standing with God. That doesn't change God's perfect standing that we have with God. God, what God creates is eternal. And so we have eternal perfect standing in God, no matter how much we pretend that we don't. So these first and second beasts, no matter what they do, they can never lose their good standing, perfect standing with God. Not good, perfect. So what's important is to not get caught up in judgment here, because that will prevent us from realizing the truth. Now, it's pretty easy to forgive somebody that you know is bad. You see someone, oh, that's someone who's bad, but I see what they're doing, and I didn't get tricked by it, and say, well, okay, I can forgive them. What's difficult is you get tricked by those you think are good, and you go along with them, and you put all your faith and trust and belief that, oh yeah, these leaders are going to lead us into some really wonderful situation, and they lead us into a hellish situation. And then you feel betrayed, so betrayed. This is what's difficult. Been there, done that, very difficult. And you want to judge them, you see, you want to judge them. What they did was so awful, they can't have perfect standing. And so this is the real problem. So it's very helpful to have someone such as this, myself, on this video channel, bringing to light these issues, and so you know ahead of time, hey, I'm not going to get tricked into thinking that they're so wonderful and they have, because then you avoid betrayal. You don't feel betrayed. You say, oh, I know, of course I knew what they're about. I never bought into it at all. And so you're much less tempted into judgment, because if you judge someone else, you're judging yourself, because all of us have equal standing with God. So if you say that someone has lessened their standing with God, you automatically believe that your standing has been lessened also. And then God is a judgmental God, and then you're in the hell of severe continuity fear and confusion. So nobody, don't judge anyone as good here. Good or bad, high status, no status, all the same. We have perfect standing with God, which is not status. We have perfect eternal, we were created that way. So how can we claim it status? Status means that you have something better than what you could have. Okay, that you've somehow excelled, or you've gained something above what you had before. Oh, I've gained this status. But we were created with perfect standing with God, eternally. No way it can ever change. This is not status. To claim status is a dualistic concept. We go say, well, I have no status. That's still dualistic. So I have neither no status nor, I neither have status nor no status, is the correct way to put it. I neither have status nor no status. Because no status can always give way to status, and status can always give way to no status. It's vulnerable. Look at the people who have high status. Are they satisfied? No. They're always craving more. More shoes, bigger shoe collection. I don't have enough shoes. I have 10,000. I need, another 10,000. And it's never enough. Status is never enough. So those who are going on this path of status are on a fool's errand, to say the least. We say, well, we can all have equal status. See, the utopia that the two beasts are leading the world towards is a utopia of equal status. This is a fool's utopia, because status never satisfies us. So we will always crave more status. As long as we believe in status, we'll always crave more status. And it's impossible. Even if we did have all equal status, we'd still be all totally dissatisfied with that. Because what we have is not status, but perfect standing, eternal perfect standing that can never be lost in the slightest bit. Nothing we can do to change it. That's not status. We don't want status at all. We don't want high status. We don't want low status. We don't want no status either. Even no status is no good. We want perfect standing in with God, which is we already have. So we want to accept what we already have and stop trying to change it. And all change is merely pretense. Since we can't change what we are, this whole belief that we're not what we are is simply pretending. We're just pretending that we've changed it. But we've been pretending that we've changed it so much that we've identified with the pretending, thinking that's our functionality, and that creativity only functions in regard to pretense. So if we stop pretending, first we think we have no function, and also believe that creativity will never, we've lost our creativity. No function, lost our creativity. We're doomed, we're annihilated, doomed. This is what we're terrified about. This is called the continuity fear. It's the only problem we have. It's the only problem anyone has. We all have exactly the same problem here, which is the continuity problem. Now, the birth of a new age, the birth of a new age. Who are going to be the midwives? Who's going to give birth to the new age, the new world order, ordering the new world? Well, the two beasts, of course. Now, did you know that the actual days that are is accepted for pregnancy is 266 days? Now, there's another way of figuring it out, which is a little more, 40 weeks instead of 38. But if you Google it, you say, time of pregnancy, days of pregnancy, it's 266 days. So someone, a woman who's pregnant, you say, well, of course she's going to give birth in 266 days. Okay, very important number. Did you know what number this pope is, starting with Peter? Just so happens that this pope is the 266th pope. Okay, final pope of Malachi's prophecy, St. Malachi's prophecy. Or is it Malachi? I think it's Malachi, yeah. Yeah. 266 pope. Last pope. Black pope. And do you know what day, September 23rd, which is where this big meeting of the two beasts is going to happen, what day on the calendar is that, September 23rd? You're probably guessing it's the 266th day, right? And it is. It is. So when does life start? Some people say life starts at conception. So the conception day of the New World Order is when the New World Order really starts. You know, looking at it that way, life starts at conception. So you say that that this pope, you know, is the pregnant pope, the 266th pope. Number of days in a pregnancy, 266. On the 266th day of the year is giving birth to the New World Order. And if you believe that birth begins at when the child is born into the world, well, if you take another very important day, which is the 28th of September, which is the last of the... sneeze is trying to build up. Okay, dissipated. If you take the last of the four blood moons, there's this tetrad four blood moons. It's happened a number of times throughout history. Each time it's happened, there's been some major, major world event take place. Well, the last of the four is on September 28th. Okay. This is also an extremely significant date. Add 266 days to that, and it brings you to what? June 21st, which is what the Holy Spirit told me, is the, you better be ready. That's the final day, because on the 22nd, June 22nd, 2016, it's going to be too late. The New World Order will get you if you're not ready by then. So the numbers are just extraordinary here. I'm not normally a number person, but you can go on and on and on. Isaac Newton, way back when, 400 some odd years ago or something, long time ago, right? The great genius Isaac Newton. In a study of biblical prophecy, he was a great student of that. He came up with the end of this age and the return of the Messiah, and everything would happen on what date? What date do you think he came up with by studying biblical prophecy? It wouldn't be September 23rd, 2015, would it? Actually, it was. That's exactly the date that Isaac Newton came up with. Pretty interesting. What is the Day of Atonement? Also Jewish Day of Atonement, I believe. And there are many, many other... This date has been embedded in all sorts of movies, actually. People have gone back and discovered all sorts of movies, television shows, music, etc. September 23rd, 2015. And it just happens that the two beasts are meeting there. The two people who are going to be most responsible for the New World Order. They already are. You know, the United Nations resolution on terrorism, on combating terrorism, which I did a video on that, which put the President of the United States in charge of structuring a global police force. Okay, a global police force, and every country in the world signed off on this, except a couple. I think North Korea didn't sign off on it, and there's maybe one other, because they're not members of the United Nations. They put him, gave him the authority to structure and design a global system of law enforcement, police force, designed to prevent, you know, terrorism anywhere in the world. He literally has the global authority already to be a global dictator. Already has the authority under the United Nations. Now the Pope is going to, not only is going to meet with the president, but is also then the next day going to address, I believe it's the next morning, will address full session of Congress. First Pope in history to ever do that. And they say that his agenda is very secular, actually. He's going to present what his New World Order agenda really is to Congress and sell them on it. After meeting with the president, agreeing, they'll agree, yeah, this is what we want. Then he's going to address the full session of the United Nations. And so this is the biggest push in history that's going on right now. This is literally, you could say, the birth of the New World Order. Or if you want to look at it as birth begins, you know, if does birth begin at conception or when the birth baby's actually born, well, that would be June 21st or 22nd, you know, in 2016, based on the blood moon count. So the numbers are right there. You know, they're just honing right in on this time. And the Holy Spirit has warned me that this time in mid-September, starting with September 11th, 9/11, and then going through the blood moon of the 28th, those 17 days. And September in general is the most precarious month of all. And the Holy Spirit's right on the money, of course. Of course. And the more people are digging into this, the more they're finding out. And it's extraordinary what they're finding out. About both of these beasts. And of course, a lot of people have known that the president is certainly one of the beasts for sure. And it is amazing how, you know, blind people can be. But, you know, the continuity fear blinds us, because we want to leadership to protect us from the continuity fear. Instead of, if you listen to the Holy Spirit, you have a leader, a friend, which helps you evaporate the continuity fear. If you don't listen to the Holy Spirit, then you will want to be protected from the continuity fear. And so the two beasts will come up with this new world order, which people will think will protect them from the continuity fear, because they feel that pretending can, there's a way to make pretending real, and we don't have to drop it then. You see, we can keep pretending forever, because it will somehow become real, and it'll become automatic. There'll be no danger of stopping our pretending. This is the hope. So, of course, those who do not listen to the Holy Spirit will fall head over heels for the two beasts and believe in them and the New World Order. This is why Jesus said, so important for you to listen to the Holy Spirit. I'm leaving so you can listen to the Holy Spirit and stop, you know, you can focus in on that. It's always with you. Prepare. Don't be like the foolish virgins who have no oil in their lamp, meaning no preparation. Be like the five that had oil in their lamps. They got into the wedding feast, no problem. The ones that didn't have oil in their lamps, they said, oh my gosh, there's a wedding feast, and I'm not ready. I'm not prepared. I got to go to market and buy the oil and put it in my lamps and come back. By the time they came back, doors are closed. Can't get into the wedding feast. It's too late. Meaning that once this New World Order gets going, and they kick it off, as they will, this is the event, these three events, the meeting between the two beasts, the second beast addressing joint session of Congress, and then addressing the full session of the United Nations, the first beast already having power over Congress. Either he gets what he wants through Congress, or he just does an executive order and bypasses Congress. And he already has power of the United Nations, because they already gave him power over, all countries gave him power to set up a global police force and a global plan, overall blueprint plan for world security, world peace. Get this. He was put, because he chaired the session, he was put, United States President, was put in charge of a global peace pen. He's already, quote unquote, the man of peace, you know, that the first beast is shown to be. That already has the authority over Congress, over the United Nations already. And now the second beast is going to come and extol the virtues of the first beast, and how we really need to listen to him, because he'll say, you know, the authority of the pontiff. And 1.2 billion Catholics, by the way, they don't all follow what he's doing. A lot of them think that he's the Antichrist. They're saying this is, you know, he's leading the church to destruction. So he's probably more popular with those who are not Catholics, you know, as possible. So he's going to say, oh, the first beast is so wonderful, you know. He sees what's really important. We need equality in the world, you know, equal status here, then we'll all be happy. Totally, totally, totally not listening to the Holy Spirit. Totally unwise. Okay, and I've brought this up in every video I've done. The extreme folly of the ego, those who listen to the advice of the continuity fear. Now, when we listen to the Holy Spirit, ultimately the continuity fear pivots and becomes our friend. And it becomes passive and accepts the remedy the Holy Spirit offers us. Because it is actually our creativity at work here. But if we don't listen to the Holy Spirit, then the continuity fear gets even more frightened. Because it says, oh my gosh, there's no way to resolve it. You know, we're really stuck. And then, you know, it becomes very aggressive in its advice. And this is a, you know, gigantic problem. Not a problem. Well, I mean, yeah, the continuity fear problem becomes very severe. The continuity, one problem we have becomes very, very severe. You look at it that way. It's not some separate problem. It would become, you know, we just don't know how to dissipate it, to evaporate it. And so we keep listening to it. And it keeps advising us in very bad ways. This whole idea of equal distribution of wealth, which is what the Pope wants, equal access to, you know, all. Everybody should just be able to invade any other country they want that has wealth and just live off the infrastructure that they've built there through hard work and intelligence and discipline and self-denial and all the virtues, you know, trying to build prosperity. That anyone should just be able to invade any other country and come in and live off that prosperity that the others have built up. That's what he wants. He wants, you know, the leveling, economic leveling around the entire world, equal distribution to everybody, on and on and on. And then, of course, extreme control based on this straw man of climate, global warming, climate change, global warming, man, you know, human-induced global warming, trying to lump it all into that as like all-important issue that everybody has to agree, you know, to do their part, otherwise we're all doomed. You know, they have a whole New World Order religion. And what he's doing is he's positioning Catholicism to be the umbrella religion that is changed its ways and now saying, no, we're now an environmental religion. You know, religion of socialism, of social justice, of environmentalism, of fairness, of equality. Now we're that religion. The Pope has been absolutely steering the Catholic Church in that direction, 100%, meeting with all the leaders of other religions, trying to say, look, we're all pretty much on the same page here. We got global warming problem. We all got to solve that problem. And so he's pivoted the church, you know, almost 180 degrees. Already, and he's positioning the church to be the umbrella church for the new world religion. This is his goal, and this has always been the goal of the Jesuits. Okay, and the Pope is a Jesuit, the first Jesuit Pope ever. Okay, and that's been their goal. They want a new world order, and they want to be the umbrella in control of that new world order here, through control of the education, religious education, catechism, indoctrination, policies, everything. So he's pivoted the whole church in the direction of the Jesuit ideology of New World Order, and they're in control of it. It's exactly what he's done. Big surprise, huh? No, it's not a big surprise at all. You know, he started to been clued into this bit by bit. Like, okay, here we go. Here are the two beasts now. Again, you know, it, feel fine. I have perfect standing. Everyone has perfect standing with God, therefore so do I. If you see that everyone has perfect standing with God, then reason will tell you, well, God has not changed our standing at all. And it's true that it's impossible. Therefore, my standing can't be changed either. So we all have perfect standing. And these two characters, these role players, pretenders, they have perfect standing with God too. We all do. No matter how we pretend, play the game of pretense, it doesn't change it in any way. But we certainly don't want to get hooked into the game of pretense, because we think that in doing so, we think it has changed. We get caught up in judgment and then the intellect and the mind and the emotions and the personality and all of this. And we're lost sheep then. The Holy Spirit leads us, shepherds us out of that lost sheep status. False status. Belief in status. So, I'm not going to dig too much into all the numbers. I mean, there's some that are just obsessed with numbers and crunching and all that, and they come up with so much stuff. It's just like, wow. But September 23rd it seems as though everything converges on that day. Historically, it's amazing, the convergences. Absolutely astonishing. And the fact that the two beasts are meeting on that day in Washington, D.C. officially just ties it all, puts a ribbon on it, right? Puts a bow, ties a bow on it all. And you just say, wow, this is it. As I have been saying, because the Holy Spirit has tipped me off to this and said, hey, it's go time. But I've never been a number person. The Holy Spirit will show me a couple things here and just to reassure me. But it just says, look, this is the trends. This is what's going on. This is what's happening. Be aware of that. But don't get obsessed with calculations and numbers. I've seen so many people get pulled down into that way too much, and they completely neglect the importance of evaporating their continuity fear. They think if they just pin the right date down, they're going to go to paradise. No. You go to paradise if you've repented. All those who have repented are going to go to paradise. Paradise is the death-free intermediate step to reality, ultimate abidance in reality. And what is repentance? Repentance means to admit that you have a severe continuity fear, and it's the only problem there is. So I only have one problem. It's the continuity problem, and it's a very severe problem. That's called repentance. As soon as you repent and really accept this fact that you do have a severe problem, it's not the world, it's not other people, it's you're the one with the problem. You've repented, and that's your ticket to paradise right there. Because then you don't need this world. This is a world that gives the illusion of multiple problems, massive numbers of problems. But if you realize, no, I only have one problem. It's the continuity problem. Without that problem, all these other problems, I'd realize they're complete pretense, gone on in an instant, as if they never existed. So how could those other problems be actual problems? They're all contingent on the continuity problem, 100%. So they're not really problems at all. They're just distractions from the one problem I do have, which is the continuity problem. Which is when we start pretending that we're not what we really are. We identify with pretending. We think if we stop pretending, we'll have no function. We will cease to exist. This is the continuity problem. So once we admit and accept that I do have this severe problem, I have a severe continuity problem, then we've repented. Okay, this is what repentance means, to recognize in your mind, to recognize, mentally recognize your situation. To reevaluate and come up with a new conclusion. Oh, I thought I had all these problems, but I really have just one problem. Repent. Repent. I'm the one who has the problem. Each one of us has to do this. It's not like, oh no, someone else has the problem. If they change it, I'd be fine. No, that's not it. Doesn't matter what anyone does in this world, we still have a severe continuity problem, because we're pretending to not be what we are. So no matter what happens in this world, good or bad or indifferent, we still have a continuity problem. Doesn't make any difference, really. Only by working directly on the continuity problem and evaporating it do we gradually get free of it. Now, so those who have repented, when they die, leave the drop, they go to paradise, which is the death-free realm, where they're able to work on evaporating their continuity problem to an extraordinarily effective way, very effective way. They have no need to come back to this world of the delusion of multiple problems, none whatsoever. In paradise, you realize, oh, I got to adjust to this. I got to adjust to perfect standing. I have perfect standing. Everything has perfect standing here. All the vegetation, everything there has perfect standing. Nothing as bad has ever happened to it. It's all been treated perfectly. No sickness, no death, no accidents, no disease, nothing. And wow, so I'm in a whole realm that has perfect standing. And you think, well, maybe I have perfect standing too. This gradually dawns upon you. You know, this really resolves our continuity problem. So there's two types of attainment. One is Jivan Mukti, which is liberation while you're still living here, where you actually accept, you know, the vision of oneness while you're still in this world, the vision of oneness. And then you can be evaporating your continuity fear very rapidly at that point, even while you're still here in this world. And the other one,
I
can't remember the name of it. I'd have to look it up. But what it means is liberation after death, meaning that you don't accept the vision of oneness while you're still here, but you've repented so that you don't have to return to this world. So after you go to paradise realm and you don't have to return to this world, that's liberation after death. So there's two types of these kind of liberations, but you can even be liberated while you're here, while you're still here in this world. It's fairly rare that this happens, actually, but it might happen in my case, it might not, I don't know. But certainly repentance has happened here, so I'm not coming back to this world, going to paradise for sure. And those who have repented, that's where they don't need to return here. Don't need to return. And the key is to recognize that I'm the one who has a continuity problem, severe continuity problem. And whether others do or not is beside the point. We know they do, but their curing of their continuity problem doesn't cure me of mine. I have to work on resolving mine. Now, it can help. It can help, but I still have a continuity problem. I have to stop pretending. You know, the fact that someone else has stopped pretending doesn't mean that I've stopped pretending. It does not mean that. I still have to stop pretending. So the fear of dropping pretense is still with all of us, and all of us have to ultimately get over that fear. Ultimately, we all have to get over that fear. And so the spiritual path is just simply getting over that fear of ending our pretense. That's all that it really is. So we don't need any new world order. You know, it's only those who have not repented who need a new world order. And so the end of the world means the end of the old world order. That's what it really means. And now we have this new world order of super control, despotic bureaucratic control over the entire world. Complete globalization of the police force to be a global police force, which the president has already been put in charge of that, to the surprise of no one. Literally. I did a video on that. I can't pull the name of that resolution, but you know, it was that big meeting on ISIS and what do we do about all these terrorists being drawn from other countries, and they decided we're going to put all these laws in place and we're all going to sign on to it. And we can completely freeze all money. We can arrest anyone that is helping any transit of terrorists. And we can block all transportation to them. In other words, you know, house arrest and no money. And of course, they're going to, as I've said, anyone who doesn't sign on, any person that doesn't sign on to the New World Order agenda is going to be seen as a global terrorist, an environmental terrorist, and they will be frozen. You know. The money will be, they want a digital system of money so that they can freeze anybody's assets immediately anywhere. You see, so if you don't sign on with the New World Order and you have gold and you have money and all this stuff, you can keep living fine. You keep go to the store and buy stuff, right? But they will make it so that you have to buy electronically. Everything has to be done electronically. So then they can flag electronically anyone they want to and freeze them out completely. This is, of course, this is their agenda. We've been told about this thousands of years, the mark of the beast. No one can buy or sell without the, you know, the RF chip, or whatever, however they're going to do it. Technology's already ready. So they will literally be able to, anyone they want to label as a terrorist, they can label them and shut off their funds, shut off their traveling. They cannot travel anywhere. They can be tracked wherever they are. And they can't buy or sell anything. Right? Starve them out, you know, just destroy them. This is exactly where they're going with this. And of course, most of the people will completely agree with this. They say, well, these people are awful. You know, they don't agree with climate change. They don't agree with, you know, this or that. And they're not, you know, helping the planet. They're planet, they're global terrorists. They're against Mother Earth, you know, this kind of stuff. This is exactly how it's going to go. And it's going to go that way very fast. President already has the authority for this global police force and enforcement activity. And these new authorizations will be coming very soon, probably from the United Nations, about a plan about global warming, about, you know, all this kind of stuff. And they'll push it through very rapidly. And the will of the people of the world, it goes along with it, because this is what the continuity fear suggests. This is its advice. And since they don't listen to the Holy Spirit, they feel that there's no way to get free of the continuity fear. It seems impossible. It seems like God. The continuity fear can seem like God to us, because it's giving us constant advice, and it seems, his advice seems to temporarily lessen our fear, and we think, oh, thank you, God, you're lessening my fear a little bit. But of course, it's just doubling down on projection, and then later on it gets worse, and then it doubles down again, and it gets even worse. So it leads us ultimately into a deep, dark hole, deep, dark, dead end, deep, dark, dead ends. But we keep thinking we're following the will of God by doing this. Blistering hot day here, last day of summer, I believe, September 20th. And so autumn, yeah, when autumn arrives, this is what I was told, Holy Spirit, this autumn will be, you better be ready, for me at least, better be, have a full head of steam. You need to take refuge this autumn. This is what I've been told. Well, it's still summer, isn't it? But tomorrow, the 21st, is autumn. I don't have a calendar here, but it's either the 21st or 22nd. I think it starts the 21st. And that just happens to be the time when the Pope is probably, you know, taken off. Well, he's in Cuba right now, I believe. And I believe he's arriving on the 22nd here. Could be the 21st arriving here, the 22nd. So right in conjunction with the beginning of autumn is this, right? Is the Pope and the two beasts coming together, right in conjunction with the beginning of autumn. And I've been told we have to take refuge starting this autumn now. And focus on right spiritual practice. Focus on clarification. It's not that difficult. We're doing it right here. Man, we just have to get better and 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 better at it. It's like that. It's like we already have the game. We already have the game. It's just like refining the game. It's like you can play basketball. You got a good game, but then you just spend time refining the game and, you know, practicing free throws, and maybe you're now hitting, you know, 85% instead of 75%. And refine your jump shot, now you hit a higher percentage, you know, your dribbling, everything's better, it's more refined, you know, becomes championship caliber. Well, you might already be good, but then you go through, you know, you raise yourself up to championship caliber. Like a Steph Curry, for instance, the Warriors. He was really, really good, but he kept working, and he turned himself into championship caliber superstar. You know, he got better. people said, "Well, he's already really good," but he said, "No, I'm not satisfied. I'm going to get, you know, significantly better." Resulted in the championship. So, you know, we want to get in championship form, is what we want to get into. So it's not enough to just be clear about all this. We want to be, you know, sparklingly clear about it. And already I'm hearing from people coming through the grapevine that it's like climate change, yeah, is responsible for all our problems. The New World Order, in order to distract us away from the realization, from repentance, which is realization, we actually all have just one problem, which is the continuity problem. In order to distract us away from that, they substitute a one problem thing, because we the Holy Spirit's telling us you have one problem, so the continuity fear says, oh yeah, we do have just one problem, that's right. Yeah, I'm saying that too, the continuity fear says. Yeah, I say that too. But their one problem, continuity fear, is climate change. They say, no, that's the one problem we have. And so many people are now becoming extremely religious about this. This is the New World Religion. Climate change is the central dogma of the New World Religion. And many people have been pointing this out, crying the alarm for a long time. And it's true. And these people are true believers now. True believers, and they'll burn you at the stake if you don't agree with them. They think this is the cause of all problems in the world, climate change. If it weren't for climate change, everything would be just peachy here. Of course, they're overlooking history, aren't they? Yeah, where there wasn't so-called man-made climate change, and it wasn't so peachy, was it? But hey, you know. You know, that don't disturb their faith, right? I would disturb my faith. I mean, you got to understand that these people going accepting the New World Order are extremely religious, extreme faith, not based on any reason whatsoever. They're extraordinary, have extraordinary faith. These people are fanatic, religious fanatics, actually. Those who repent are just following reason. They're not religious fanatics at all, just the opposite. Religious fanaticism is to believe in something that doesn't have any sound foundation in reason or truth. And to claim that all our problems are caused by global warming is absolute religious, fanatical religious dogma based on total faith and not reason at all. Now, you can say, well, there's some global warming taking place. Yeah, well, yeah. So, is that... Does that mean it's the cause of all our problems? Really? Our existential problem of continuity fear is caused by global warming? Really? You know, that takes a complete blind faith to believe in that. Absolute blind faith. The Holy Spirit's never said a word about climate change to me. It says the problem is a continuity problem. There isn't any other problem. Again, without this continuity problem, everything would be exactly the way we want it. We would let go of all misery, all suffering, all pretense instantly. And we'd realize everything is absolutely perfect. We're perfect. All is perfect. There's zero problems whatsoever. None. Impossible. So it's the continuity problem that's the problem, not anything else. So this is the division of the sheep and the goats that we're talking about, the separation, the parting of the ways. Those who are going to continue following the advice of a continuity fear, in order to do that, we'll have to feel that they have an answer to the Holy Spirit. They say, no, it's not continuity fear, it's global warming. It's climate change that's the problem. Yeah, we have one problem. We're just as religious as you. We're just as wise. We agree there's one problem, too. That puts us on the same level, you know. We both agree there's one problem, but we just disagree what the problem is. And so this is the parting of the ways, you know, that we've been told about. The sheep and the goats go different directions, of course. One stay in this, you know, nightmare we call the world. Others go to paradise, death-free realm, which I've already been shown, already been there. And You know, after a while, I freaked out, and then I've had to get, work really intensely to, evaporate my continuity fear about this and the whole status issue and all this kind of stuff. And understand what it's for. It's to help us realize we all have perfect standing in reality, and we can do that by seeing an entire realm where everything, all nature, has perfect standing. What a world that is, and what a realm that is! Imagine such a realm. I've experienced it. Every tree you see, everything you see, you say, my gosh, that has had perfect standing from the very beginning of its existence. It's always never suffered misfortune of any type whatsoever. It's always been immaculately healthy, expressing itself perfectly since the very beginning of its expression. It's been flawless, it has perfect standing. Everything you see is that way there. And then, of course, this enables us to say, hey, if I just get used to this, I'll get really used to the idea of having perfect standing. And then, hey, son of a gun, that's easily translated into, I can accept that I have perfect standing too. You see how that works? Very simple, very simple. So once you see that's the purpose of the place, wonderful. Okay. Good to go. So it's all about taking refuge right now in the world. It's a trick. So these poor people that, the continuity fear just makes mincemeat out of them. I mean, they can't reason. Yeah, sure, there's some man-made global warming, and there's some climate change, and blah, blah, blah. Yeah, the world has a way of balancing things out. And so, but they can't, they can't reason it out. They become fanatical. Faithful fanatics. And they fail to see the option. Well, why don't we just go to paradise? Why don't we just be enlightened here? That would take care of it. Oh, no, we have to, the continuity fear can't allow that. It has to keep feeding people materially. They just say, well, no, we got to get more people in the world, and how are we going to do that and avoid more goods and more, but you still have to avoid climate, problems and this and this and this. And so everybody has to be, regulated very carefully and make sure everyone gets equal amounts. And, it goes into this obsession. It goes into total obsession. Terrible. Obsession is not a good thing to go into. It may seem like fun for a while, but then it starts biting you very badly. And, they just can't see any road other than the one that the continuity fear is pointing out to them. It seems plausible, but it's not reasonable, actually. Reason is absent. Because you might say, why don't you just everyone listen to the Holy Spirit? No, that's religious. What are you talking about? What do you mean religious? I mean, it's just reasonable. I thought religion was based on just faith in something you couldn't really see or reason out or anything else. It just, has to be based on faith. And of course, they're the ones that are going on faith. They're going down a road based entirely on faith. Whereas those who follow the Holy Spirit are really following a path entirely based on reason. They don't see that they're the ones who are religious fanatics. Not the ones who are going to paradise. Those are ones who are not religious fanatics at all. They're very, very, very even-keeled, wise, based on reason. They don't need faith. It's based on reason, actually. They can use faith as a tool, but it's not an end in itself at all. Because faith just leads you. Faith tells you to just trust in the reason that you've already seen, that you've seen reason, you've seen the clarity, and just keep trusting in that. That's the right use of faith. Faith in the Holy Spirit. You know the Holy Spirit's guiding us properly, so, you know, just keep going with that. That's the right use of faith. You can use faith in the wrong way too, which is what the New World Order is doing. They're using faith in the wrong way. There's no faith in reality at all. There's no need for it any. Because we have perfect awareness, perfect knowing of all. So everything's completely in the open. There's no reason. There's no need for faith in the slightest bit in reality, actually. So faith is just a tool of perception. And it can be used either the helpful way or harmful way. And the New World Order is using it in a very, very harmful way. And of course, people are very proud of their faith. They don't understand. It's a new religion that's coming about. Earth-based religion, environmental religion, earth-based religion, socialist religion. You know, all these things are going to be lumped into one thing, which is exactly what the two beasts are all about. You look at these two beasts, what's their ideology? It's exactly that. Lumping all these things into one faith dogma. You know, dogma, which is how religions start. You get this, a bunch of issues that all get lumped together into a fundamental faith. It's the birth of a new religion. It's coming up the 23rd of September. It's the birth of a new religion. New World Order based on a new world religion. We have environmental activism, social justice, socialism, redistribution of wealth, fundamental rights of being able to take from what others have to make your get if you have a lack, be able to take from others what they have. And ecumenicalism, which thinks that all religions are the same, they're all agreeing that in the basic principles of human rights that we're all human. You know, as human, isn't it? Agreed that we're all religions agree that we're all fundamentally human. Well, Jesus doesn't agree with that. Buddha doesn't either, and there are many, many, many leaders of great religions who would say that's absolutely false. We're actually divine. We're just divinity pretending to be not divinity, pretending to be, you know, dead, not what we are. Holy Spirit doesn't agree. And if what kind of religion is it that doesn't listen to the grace of God, the voice of reason, whatever you call it? You know, they have different terms for it. Depending what the religion is, but what kind of religion is it that doesn't put faith in the in divine guidance through the grace of God? It's not a real religion at all. You call it a secular religion. It's really socialism that's the opiate of the masses. You know, socialism claims that religion's the opiate of the masses. No, it's socialism that's the opiate of the masses. It's this new world order that's the opiate of the masses. Most certainly. So they're not fooling everybody. But the problem is that a lot of people who are not fooled have not paid attention to the Holy Spirit enough. So they still feel they got to battle it out here and don't realize that they can go to paradise, you know. Sheep and the goats parting ways. Repent. They have not repented yet. A lot of these people have not repented. They're just saying, hey, we want the old order to remain. Well, the old order, you know, is not necessarily any great thing at all either, right? If you haven't repented, then it's just all continuity fear. So you're saying, well, I like the old style of continuity fear better than the new style of continuity fear. What is that? That's not salvation. And so they want to fight it out, you know, and it's going to go bad for them. And they think Jesus is coming back to help them fight it out. No, Jesus is not coming back to help anybody fight it out. He said very clearly, I'm coming back to bring you to paradise, those who have repented. It's very simple. Jesus isn't coming back to bring about some new world order, some socialist, environmentalist, you know, continuity fear, global climate change is the only problem, new world order. Not at all. So those who want to remain in some continuity, fear, order, you know, they're not listening to the Holy Spirit. They're not repenting. They haven't repented. It's very clear, in order to get into quote-unquote heaven, you have to repent. You have to admit that you have a problem. That means you can solve the problem. You can set it. You can work on it. Paradise helps you work on it. If you go to paradise and you haven't repented, you'll get paranoid. You say, well, what am I here? I don't need this. It's the others that need it. They're not here. So that means I still have a problem because they're not here. And then you go back, you know, you say, no, no, no. Wow. A sneeze almost hit me. That was really close. Wow. It snuck up on me. I'm getting all sort of tingling in my chin. Suddenly, wham. Whoa. So, repent. It's the greatest thing ever because you realize, hey, wait a minute. My problems, I have the problem. It's mine. That means I can set it down. As long as you think that someone else has the problem that's causing you suffering, you're not in control. You think you have to control them. So those who do not repent are control freaks, plain and simple. In a fundamental way, they say, I have to control everybody else because they're the ones that are causing me to suffer, not because I have a problem, because they do. And therefore, I have to stay around them to cure them. I have to, you know, solve their problems because that's the only reason why I have a problem. This is hell. But when you realize that the suffering you're undergoing is entirely because the problem you have, then you say, oh my gosh, that means if I get rid of this problem, I won't be suffering anymore. Doesn't matter what others do, I won't be suffering anymore. And that's true. And then you say, oh, well, let me get to work on it then. That's great. Wonderful. Best news ever. That I'm the one who has the problem. I have the problem that's causing me my suffering. My suffering is entirely due to my problem, the continuity problem that I have. Nobody else is actually causing me suffering because I'm choosing how I feel. I mean, how I feel is entirely my choice, 100%. 100% how I feel. It's entirely my choice. It's not dependent on anything whatsoever. I could choose to feel perfect right now, perfect standing right now, and I would feel that way. Has nothing, how we feel, has no, the world and the universe has nothing to do with how we feel, actually. Nothing to do with it. We're just pretending it does. Trying to say that we've changed what we are. Because in reality, you know, how we feel actually was created by God. We can't change it. It's perfect. So when you say I'm totally in control of how I feel, meaning I can stop trying to change how I feel and I'll feel perfect. That's it. All the feeling that I'm having now is based on I'm trying to change on my how I feel. I'm trying to change my perfect standing in the one family of God. I'm trying to change it. So that's why I'm feeling all this instability and variability and all this kind of stuff. But really, I can give that up. See, I can give that up. My only problem is my continuity problem, and I'm afraid to give up this attempt to change what I am. That's it. Yeah, nice heat up today, nearly. Wonderful summer day. Summer should be hot. You know, if you don't have a hot summer, why have summer at all? Let it bake. So say goodbye to summer after this day, huh? Now we're in the autumn of discontent here in the world. Gotta take refuge in this autumn. We have to take refuge in some way here. Now, we don't want to take refuge in any way except additional clarification. More potent clarification. More potent clarification. It's a temporary expedient. It's not an end in itself. Just because we take refuge here doesn't mean that we're going to be denied paradise. Not at all. Not at all. Not at all. This just protects our decision for paradise here is what we need. It consolidates it, you know. We make sure that it's consolidated and we don't let it slip away. This is what's important. So the continuity fear will try to lie to us about this, saying, no, well, if you accept a refuge here in protection from all this, that means that you've made a deal and you've given up paradise and you're trying to do it here. No, it doesn't mean that at all, continuity fear. That's a total lie. No matter how much help we have here, the paradise is always there for us, and we need to go through that death-free realm. We need to go through that. And we get to go through it. It's wonderful. I mean, why would we want to miss that? Talk about honoring our creativity. There's no better way than that. But we can honor our creativity even here in this world. This is what Jesus tells us, if we so choose. Now, some of us might do that, some of us may not, but that doesn't mean we can't take refuge also. Absolutely, we can take refuge. I've said that I hope, it seems the indications are that some great means of refuge will be made available to us here. This time, the means of refuge will be made available to us. However that turns out, you know, I don't sweat those kind of details. It's just the big pictures. And what's important, if the Holy Spirit says the means of refuge will be made available, then they will. I don't really care the form it takes. Doesn't really matter. Refuge is refuge. What does that do? Maintains our repentance. What does maintaining our repentance do? It's a ticket to paradise. Death-free realm is what it really is. So you want to keep that ticket. You don't want someone to steal your ticket, do you? And of course, remember, paradise is the ultimate, most potent reminder of that we have perfect standing with God, and all has perfect standing with God. Everything God created has perfect standing with God. Forever. It can never change. There's no way to change it. Even Lucifer hasn't changed Lucifer's standing with God. If you want to use that, whether you think it's a myth or real, but it doesn't matter. I'm just using it as an example. Take the most extreme example. You can't, Lucifer, for instance, you know, the one who started the rebellion of trying to be greater than God, supposedly. Even Lucifer has not changed its standing in the one family. It's perfect standing with God in the one family. Not in the slightest bit. Not in the slightest bit. Those who claim that God's going to destroy Lucifer, cast him into dark pit, and annihilate all those who don't do right, is nonsense. Dualistic nonsense. Totally false teaching. Not one single member of the one spirit family of spirit that God created can ever lose its perfect standing and inclusiveness in the slightest bit, not even the tiniest bit, no matter what, how they may pretend that they can. They cannot. Now, Lucifer may have a difficult time with the continuity fear, as we all do, thinking that I had the power to change God, but I couldn't. You know, it's like, oh my gosh, I'm not greater than God. I'm not greater than, and it's pride of spiritual arrogance. But the Holy Spirit will lead everyone back to recognizing, you know, forgiving themselves, and saying I was just out of an abundance of adventurousness. You know, that's all. Everyone will be led back to, you know, full salvation. Full recognition, full acceptance of that they have perfect standing in God. All spirits will be led back by the Holy Spirit to this. No exceptions whatsoever. None. So why sit around trying to make judging, you know, well, what about them? What about them? It is a complete waste of time. You know, what about Hitler? What about Genghis Khan? What about this? It's a complete waste of time. There's no exceptions at all. So what are we doing here in this world judging? This is ridiculous. This world's ridiculous. You know, it's those who want to judge go to this world and waste their time trying to judge. There's no judgment in God. There's no judgment in reality. Everything that God has created perfect forever and forever and forever. And there's no way that can be changed at all. So this whole game of judgment, you know, is just a total waste of time. And in the death-free realm, you see, you know, there's nothing to judge. Everything is perfect. It's flawless. It's like in perfect good standing. You know, there's no differentiation as far as, well, this has better, higher standing than this. No, it doesn't exist there. And so it helps us, you know, set our judgment down. So, but right now, autumn, taking refuge. If we, immediate task ahead of us as autumn starts, either today or tomorrow. Either way, it's to say, right, we're in the conjunction now of summer and autumn. And this is when we need to take refuge. We need to take refuge. I'll tell you a really funny story. It's true. I don't make up stories. When I tell you something, it's actually happened. So, I've been criticizing the Holy Spirit a little bit. Where's the beef? Where's the beef? You know, you keep giving me all these signs that's coming. It's coming. Where? But where's the beef? You know, that old famous commercial, it's entered into our lexicon. Where's the beef? You know, you promise us, you know, this meal, but you give us just this, you know, hamburger bun with lettuce and mayo on it, you know, but where's the beef? You know, that's just symbolic. Where's the beef? Come on. So I said, Holy Spirit, look, where's the refuge? Where's the refuge? You've been telling me there's a refuge. Got to take refuge. Where's the refuge? Where's the beef? I really literally was saying that. I was chiding the Holy Spirit. Where's the beef? Well, this is quite extraordinary. You know, and out of doing a favor for somebody, somebody just gave us this box full of all this New Zealand organic grass-fed beef, frozen beef, you know, tri-tip sirloin of that, the finest beef in the world. You know, they just gave us an entire box of it, and we have it in our freezer right now. All this beef. I don't even eat beef. You know, I'm a vegetarian. But the Holy Spirit says, where's the beef? Here's the beef, you know? It's never happened to me in my life. It's just someone just out of the blue just gave us this box of frozen beef, all packaged in plastic, you know, frozen. It was delivered to them fresh that very day. Here's the beef. Here's a box of beef for you. And as soon as I saw that, I started laughing. I said, the Holy Spirit's got a sense of humor. Since you're complaining about beef, well, here's the beef. Or maybe that was the continuity fear saying, you want beef? I got the beef for you. Don't worry. I don't know. Either way, it's pretty funny. It could be the continuity fear. I say, come on, where's the beef? And the continuity fear says, oh, Holy Spirit's not giving you the beef. I got beef for you. Here. Look, here's the beef right here. I said, but I don't eat that kind of beef. I meant, where's the refuge? Is it still going? Yeah, it's jumping around. I don't know. It's one or the other. Either the Holy Spirit's just sending a little calling card, said, don't worry about the beef. I got the beef. Hilarious. Just hilarious. My gosh. Got burgers, beef burgers. I mean, I don't know how many, like 20 of them, like huge beef burgers, you know. 20 beef burgers. We can throw a party. Of course, I'm also aware people don't eat meat. It's kind of weird if you think about it, ground up muscle, kill an animal, then grind up its muscle, all its muscle tissue, and eat it. I mean, that's kind of weird you start thinking about it, actually. So, refuge. Conjunction of summer and autumn, this is when we need to take refuge now, because this new world order is going to come out blazing, guns blazing, folks. Don't underestimate the tidal change that's going to happen now. It's a tidal change in the world. There's no question about it. And they'll use whatever false flags they need to use. I mean, they'll pull out all the stops if they need to. You know, they're going to, by hook or by crook, they're going to pull people. This is going to happen. So if people go along with it, then they'll say, okay. If people drag their heels, they'll say, well, we're going to, you know, do this extreme false flag maneuvers and stampede you into it. You know, you're going to get, either you're going to get into the pen docilely, or you're going to be stampeded in there. And so, refuge, 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 refuge. So we're waiting for refuge, we're preparing for refuge, however that may show up. I don't know. I've been given some clues for sure. Some, you know, calling cards. Like that elephant with the Maharaj on it, the Maharaj arriving. Well, Maharaj is often used as a term for great enlightened being. The elephant is also a symbol. Riding on a totally peaceful, docile elephant means that they've subdued the animal nature completely. The elephant is absolutely peaceful and tranquil, as opposed to an elephant that's rambunctious and rampaging around, saying, look how smart I am, look how powerful I am, you know, that kind of thing. Now, this is a huge elephant, absolutely calm and wise and peaceful. No reactivity at all in the elephant. No continuity fear in the elephant. See, this is the Maharaj is riding this vehicle. It's the great vehicle. Mahayana, the great vehicle. The great vehicle. The great elephant. The Maharaj on the great elephant. This is what I was given. I was given this by someone from India. And by the way, that dream I had of the elephants, I can't remember the video, the name of it. I should have said the elephant dream. I was on this very jagged outcropping. I had climbed into this mountain, sort of, but it was like a rock, and very jagged rock, and it got like incredibly jagged, like super sharp coral. And I couldn't get down. It was too dangerous. And these huge elephants came and they asked, would you like us to lift you off of there? And I said, yeah. And they lifted me off of there, and they said, we're headed toward this other constellation, this other realm. Would you like to come along? I said, sure, let's go. Well, jagged also means jagad, which means world. The jagad guru means the world guru. So jagged, it was shown to me in the dream, it's this really jagged place. It meant the world. This is what it really meant. It meant the world. And the world is a jagged place, isn't it? Jagged with fear. Everyone is very sharply jagged in their personalities of fear. Well, it really meant I was going to be lifted off of this world. This is what the dream showed. The jagad means this world. Jagged, so it means. Would you like to be lifted off this world? I said, sure. And here you go. And I said, okay, there's another, we'll take you, now we're going to take you to this another realm. And I think it was like three elephants or something. I don't remember exactly how many. But they were enormous. They're bigger than the entire world. They're bigger than the world. But they're also completely wise and composed and purposeful and kind and friendly and non-reactive and no fear, you know. No insecurity about status. They knew they had perfect standing. You know, elephants have massive standing, right? You see someone standing, elephant standing, you say, wow, look at that standing they're having. Well, this represented those who know they have perfect standing in God. So they're enormous, you know. It's just to symbolize it, you can't have it symbolize it as the absolute, because then that's not a symbol. But so to symbolize these enormous elephants, it's a very good symbol of having perfect standing with God, realizing that they're perfect standing and that everyone has perfect standing. So, all this is really happening. You know, all this is really happening. Whether you do it by the numbers or by spiritual intuition and awareness and clarity and all this, it all adds up. Now, a lot of Christians think, okay, it's the time Jesus returned. They're ready to go. Really? They're ready to go? Have they know where they're going? paradise. They know what paradise is for. They're going to accept that. They've repented. They're very clear about all this, and they prepared properly. Is that true? I don't know. I haven't heard any rhetoric from them that indicates that's true at all. All I hear is like Jesus coming back and he's going to destroy everybody, or, you know, we're going to be raptured, but everybody else is going to be annihilated, and that's good because they're my enemies. And I mean, raptured where? They said, well, it can be raptured. Said, well, you know, heaven. Well, what's heaven like? I don't know. Well, I know where we're going, which is paradise, a death-free realm. I've been there. I know what it's like. And so I know that it's purposeful. It helps remove the final roots of our continuity fear entirely, so we can accept that all has perfect standing in reality, perfect standing with God, that can never be changed. This is what it's for. This is what the death-free realm is for. It's an expedient. It's a pragmatic expedient. It's a very helpful expedient. And once we have finally been translated back to full awareness of reality and a perfect standing, then we don't even need the death-free realm at all. We don't even need it at that point. But it will remain until we all have, everyone has accepted that, you know, that everyone has perfect standing with God. But it will remain as a useful expedient, a very helpful expedient. So, you know, I mean, the Christians are all talking about trying to pinpoint the rapture, like the exact date, exact time, even though they're told not to do that, not to try to do that, because it's a waste of time. When it gets close, the Holy Spirit will let you know. That's all that's happened to me. I didn't worry too much about it at all. Holy Spirit just says, it's getting close, so keep working. So I keep preparing. So, okay, I'll do that. Now the Holy Spirit says, it's very close. Okay, great. Keep preparing. But, you know, it's somewhat like the foolish virgins who are kind of pinpoint the date, and they're spending all their time trying to say, I got to get the right date. And then when the time comes, they don't have no oil in their lamps. So they haven't been preparing their spirit for paradise. Because you got to, you know, rapture is to somewhere, you know. It's to paradise. It's to the death-free realm. And if you haven't prepared for that, then you're going to refuse to go. You'll feel paranoid about it. You'll flip into too much wow, you know, and you don't know how to handle it. I've already experienced that. I mean, I went there, and I flipped into too much wow, and then I got frightened. This is exactly, if you haven't prepared, this is what will happen. And then you'll go, you know, into what's called limbo or purgatory, or, you know, the after death realm of some experiencing that prepares you to, you know, go back to another, you know, world, flesh world, because you didn't really prepare, you didn't really repent. You know, just pinpoint the date is not repentance. That doesn't mean you've repented. Doesn't mean that anyone does that. It doesn't mean they've repented at all. It doesn't say, oh, Jesus, I'm so happy you're going to be back, because they think, well, when Jesus comes back, he's going to destroy my enemy somehow. That's not repentance. Keep in mind, the problem is not anybody else. It's our continuity fear. And Jesus is not coming back to destroy our continuity fear. He's coming back to gently help us and encourage us to gradually evaporate our continuity fear, which is what the Holy Spirit has been telling us all along to do. And ultimately, Jesus is coming back to take those who have, supposedly, we don't know until it happens, I guess, but who've truly repented and prepared, you know, Jesus will say, well, there's a death-free realm, you know, would you like to go there? I mean, at some point, and say, I'll say, well, yeah, at some point, when the time is right, you know, then we'll go there, sure. He's not coming back to attack anybody or force anybody or anything like that. What I heard him say is, he said, I've come back just to relate with people as a friend, just here to just, you know, just have relate as a friend. That's all. Not trying to force anything upon you. Of course, friends do tell each other, one another, about good situations, right? You find a good restaurant, what do? You tell your friends, right? Of course, if you find a really nice park, what are you going to say? You're going to say, hey, friends, look, I found this really, really nice park. Well, if I find a good golf course, what do? I tell my friends, hey, not that I have any friends to tell, but if I meet someone who's friendly, I'll tell them, hey, I know this really, really, really good golf course. You got to check it out. It's fantastic. And they'll say, oh, thanks. Wow, I'll try to do that. That's what friends are for, right? The friends tell each other about the good stuff that they know about. They share the good news with each other. So Jesus said, I'm coming back just as a friend. What does he mean? Well, that means he's sharing the good news with us. That's what he really means. He's going to tell us, hey, friend, you know, there is this death-free realm, you know, which is absolutely wonderful. And you know what? You can actually go there. I'm just telling you that if you want to. I'm just from a friend to friend. That's what I'm telling you. I'm not saying you have to go there. You must go there. You know, in order to attain good standing with God, you got to go there. If you don't go there, you're going to lose good standing with God. I'm not saying any of that at all. I'm saying it's impossible to change your standing with God, no matter what you do. You can stay in hell for all eternity and then you still won't change your standing with God in the slightest bit. So it's a rather foolish thing to do. You know, I mean, what's the point? But you can if you want. That's the truth. So Jesus just shares the good news with his friends. We're all just his friends. We have equal standing with Jesus. Keep in mind, we all have equal standing in God. There's none higher or lower. None higher or lower. This is absolutely true. Now, supposedly Jesus says he was put in charge of the atonement. Okay. Why? Because he realized the truth that we all have equal standing. So the fact that he was put in charge of the atonement, he knows that doesn't make him any better than us at all. And he was able to accept that fact, which is, you know, quite difficult, you know, I would say. So much respect to Jesus for being able to do that is someone who's accepted, perfectly accepted it, that I can never be greater than anyone. And conversely, no one can ever be greater than me either. We all have perfect standing in God, meaning perfect freedom. We all have absolute, immaculate, perfect freedom. So nobody can be better than anyone else. So in accepting this, then it was safe for Jesus to be put in charge of the atonement process, you know, in some way. I don't know what that entails, really. But so he doesn't think he's better than us. I mean, pragmatically, he has greater pragmatic advice, you know. I mean, his advice is better temporarily, but his standing with God is no different than ours, actually. No, not in the slightest bit. He has experience and wisdom in helping us pragmatically evaporate our continuity fear. So you might say he's very helpful. He might be more helpful at this continuity fear issue than we are, but that doesn't change our standing or his standing at all with God, not in the slightest bit. He's not earning brownie points by doing this, okay? With God, there's no brownie points with God. We cannot earn status with God. It's impossible. So he knows that. So he's not gaining any status with God. He's not gaining higher, you know. He's not like he's being elevated or something with God. No, it's not that. God's not like that at all. We all have perfect standing with God, absolutely all free forever and ever and ever. Nothing can ever happen to change that. It's impossible. So you cannot earn some, you know, points with God. It's not possible. So you're simply doing it out of compassion. See, all the great teachers, it's out of compassion. They know they're not earning any points with God by doing this. No. If they didn't do it, they wouldn't lose any standing with God at all. God wouldn't say, oh, I'm disappointed in you, you know, you're not helping out. And no, we still have perfect status, perfect freedom. It's hard for us to understand this for sure. I mean, I'm having trouble, you know, that God would not be disappointed. No, God cannot be disappointed in us. It's impossible. So it's very, you know, their attitude for us is incomprehensible at this point, because they, you know, to say that, well, if they didn't help us, that wouldn't cause displeasure in God. No, it wouldn't. That's right now, that's a little bit beyond me. But I know it's true. I have faith that this absolutely is true. It has to be. Reason tells me it must be true. So that's, well, we'll find out what that's all about. But they do realize that they cannot be entirely, they don't feel, they feel perfect, yet it seems as though reality is not being fulfilled, you know, and so they know that everyone has to ultimately stop, drop their pretense in order for reality to truly be fulfilled the way that it, you know, it really is. That there is some sort of, Jesus said, there's some sort of, from the standpoint of God and all that is, there's a feeling like that the fullness is, it is not quite the fullness expression that God wants. It's not quite by us pretending to not be what we are. Jesus hints that there's something like that. It's not a lack of perfection or standing or anything like that. And it's not a suffering or anything like that. It's just that there's some sort of pressure. He said there is some sort of pressure that has felt like a positive pressure, though, you know, but that we need to ultimately, everyone is called back to, you know, to drop their pretense. But this is a subtle issue. We don't have to worry about this, really. When we get there, we'll find out when we get there by repentance. And ultimately, Jesus, a friend, informs friends about, you know, what the good stuff they know about, also warns them about the dangers. If you know there's a speed trap somewhere and the police are hiding there, you know, you say, hey, I saw a speed trap there, you know, be careful, slow down. Oh, thanks. So they also warn them about traps also. So friends, that's, they warn them about traps, or don't go to that restaurant, it's terrible, believe me, it's awful. It's marketed itself really great, but it's actually really, you know, terrible, don't go there. Oh, okay, thanks, I'm not going to waste my time then. And friends trust friends. So if a friend tells you a place is terrible, they say, I know what you're like, what you like, and what your standards are, and I know this place is way below your standards, so don't waste your time. Then you don't waste your time going there. So friends save you time. Plus, they inform you about what's really, really great. So they save you time, and they guide you into what you really want. So Jesus is just a friend, a great friend, who saves us time and helps guide us into what we really want, saying, oh yeah, you should try this golf course. It's absolutely fabulous. To use an analogy, and we try it out, and it turns out, oh my gosh, it's absolutely fabulous. Wow, I never would have known this. So this is how it goes. Those who are going to take refuge, everyone's going to take refuge now this autumn. Those who are going with the New World Order are going to try to take refuge from those who are not, and try to isolate themselves from them. And those who are going to go with repentance, death-free realm, paradise, salvation, continuity, fear, you know, acceptance, and working on it, they want to be isolated from those from the New World Order. They want to take refuge from that storm, you see. So both sides will be taking refuge from one another now. This is the separation process, the wheat from the chaff, wheat from the tares, wheat from the weeds. That which is nourishing from that which is just weeds. So Jesus is back to just as a friend to tell us, give us advice, you know. That's what friends do to one another. Share good advice with one another. And he said, that's why what I'm back for now. That's what I'm going to do, is essentially share good advice with you. So bring it on, Jesus. Let's go. Let's start listening to your advice. It's time. You know, both is and isn't pressure. I mean, we have an internal pressure because we want to be what we really want to be. What we really want is what we really want. So we are drawn to that. You know, it is an inner pressure we have. So he'll help, you know, give us good advice as how can we, you know, fulfill that inner desire. What we really want is to realize we have perfect standing. Nobody has lost it. Everyone has perfect standing. This is what's crucial. Everyone. No, they can't lose it. This is what we really want. We want to see this. It's called the vision of oneness. That we want to see this. We want to experience it. We want to abide in this. We want to be certain of it at all times. And certainly a death-free realm will bring that about for us, where we become absolutely certain ultimately. And it can even do it here. We can even have a vision, abiding the vision of oneness of here. Some great teachers have done this. But if you don't do it, it doesn't change your standing at all, right? Keep that in mind. It doesn't. I found it to be quite difficult. It's like challenging. Quite challenging. Because this whole, you know, families and friends and people and pressure and society and, you know, it's just, some can do it and wonderful. I'm so happy for them. That's very helpful. And the problem is, of course, the New World Order people will be proselytizing very strongly. We had a proselytizer come here yesterday, this young maiden, beautiful young maiden. She was proselytizing for the New World Order, had her environmental thing or whatever, you know, they used to get you hooked into it. And I said, I'm working here. I can't entertain you. And she goes, oh, and she left, you know. This is very, very important. Pass that test. Very important test, because the New World Order is can't believe that anybody would not want to be part of their religion. You know, just this is what religious people have always been like. I can't believe you don't want to be part of this, you know. You must be crazy. Of course, when it comes with repentance, it's accurate. But otherwise, it's not. If it's a continuity fear religion, it's then, of course, it's not accurate. But people say, I can't believe you don't want to be part of this New World Order. It's going to be fabulous. We're going to heal the planet. We're going to have equality. Everyone's going to have peace here. My gosh, this is like the best time ever. This is how they feel. They're going to be very aggressive and proselytizing. And of course, they send out these young maidens all over the place. This is, and they can be very aggressive. These young maidens, they've been prepared for this. And I talked to young men. And they just volunteered. They said the young women right now are just absolutely vile. Absolutely vile. I mean, they just feel they can get what they want, period. Whatever it is, they'll do whatever it takes to get what they want. They'll play dirty, they'll play hit below the belt, to do anything. They have no shame. No shame whatsoever. They're gross. You know, these are very gross. And so they will go after everyone they can to proselytize, you know. Absolutely. I mean, in the Jesus freaks in the 60s, 70s, there was this group, and literally what they did to hook people for Jesus, they had a whole prostitution ring, actually. And the young women in that Jesus freak group, they were prostitutes, plain and simple, and they would say that Jesus loves you, and to show his love, free sex, you know, with the men. They didn't charge anything, but the purpose was to hook them into this cult. And they didn't see anything wrong with it. They said, I'm doing this for Jesus. So, so the pointing out is these young maidens proselytizing for the New World Order, they'll do whatever it takes. They truly believe that this is your salvation. Very bad situation. And hell hath no fury like a proselyte scorned. Religious proselyte scorned. To say the least, right? And so you want to take refuge from that. You don't want these proselytes determined to pull you down into their New World Order religion. And it's true, is the young women seem to have no shame, no conscience. They've grown up in a time where, you know, they call it women's liberation, which means that they use their body any way they want to, that nobody can tell them how to use their body, and however they use it, it's good, it's justified. So they'll use it for the proselytize for this New World Order. There's no question about it. They'll use it any way they want to, and they feel no guilt or shame or moral problem about it whatsoever. It's a very dangerous situation for men and women. Keep in mind, they'll go after women too, the same way. The same way. That's this whole bisexual thing is because of that. They prepare to proselytize for the New World Order. The women will go after women just as aggressively as they go after men. And the same with the men proselytes. They'll go after women and men aggressively. But there's not as many of them as there are women. That's for sure. And of course, the young maidens also very persuasive to older women, saying, you know, look, the New World Order, you know, you'll be able to stay young and healthy and beautiful like me. You'll be very attractive. You won't have any hang-ups about making yourself super attractive, and you can remain sexually active until you're 100, you know, and you know, you got no restraints on your pleasure and all this stuff. So, you know, and the old women are like, oh my God, really? I can be young again? Like, it's okay, you know. Yeah, of course it is. And don't you want to help, you know, you don't, all the repression you had to go through, just think of a world where there's no repression at all. You just, if it feels good, you can just do it, you know, no problem. And the older women are really suckers for this, absolutely suckers for it. Of course, you have to use a lot of discipline in this world to avoid falling into the traps the continuity fear is setting for you, the snares, you know. It's constantly trying to sell its wretched agenda by some sort of cheap sensory thrill. Sensuality, it's called. It uses sensuality as its prime marketing device. So of course you have to avoid sensuality as much as possible. But they say, hey, you don't have to avoid sensuality anymore. Actually, sensuality is now the great good, you know. It's just the Holy Spirit was lying to you. They say, you know, it's sensuality that's the real the gift that God gave everyone to be happy, and you just have to indulge in it without any inhibitions or hang-ups, and then you'll be truly happy. This is the whole, you know, the 60 star, that whole thing. It was all, you know, it was a New World Order plot, actually. It absolutely was. They've been working on this for a long time. And what they wanted to do is sell everybody on sensuality. And so the hippies, not just the hippies, the whole youth generation of the 60s was, you know, free love, feels good, just do it. You need to indulge your sensuality. You need to get rid of hang-ups. So the whole thing, the way they were dancing and everything, was get rid of your hang-ups, you know, your moral hang-ups. They thought all morality was just hang-ups. It's keeping you from being happy, from being truly human. You know, this is all complete Aquarian Age conspiracy, New World Order, continuity fear propaganda, brainwashing. It's absolute nonsense. All of it. And yet, this is what's gotten into the culture, thinking, oh yeah, sensuality. I just need to be more sensual, more sensual, and more sensual. Need to eat a lot of beef, you know, to get more animalistic. Got to be more animalistic. What's the matter with me, you know? Look at those animals, you know, they have no hang-ups. Got to be more like an animal. That's the way to be happy. Look at animals, they're so happy, you know. Got to be more like that. And so they're led into the terrible quagmire that way. They don't identify what their problem is for so long. They just keep going deeper and deeper and deeper into the quagmire until they're in, you know, then they're sinking into quicksand. And they say, help, help, help. And the ego, Conifer, doesn't do any help. The ego, Conifer says, what do you mean, help? You're fine. Everything's great. This is where you should be. Just enjoy it, you know. And what do you mean? I'm sinking into the quicksand. And then help, help, help. And then who shows up? Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit says, don't worry, I'll get you out of there. You just got to start working, listen, and start working on your continuity fear. You got a problem, continuity fear problem. And then right then and there you realize, oh, I'm going to get out of this quicksand. I just got to stop struggling so severely and screaming and struggling. And, you know, where's the continuity fear? He says, just indulge in more sensuality. That's the answer. But that's what's pulling me down. No, 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 you need more. Here, have some drugs. That'll loosen you up. You've just been too inhibited. That's why you're not happy about it. Just let out those primal screams and get uninhibited, and you'll be fine. This is what it says. A little break here, you know. Catch our breath. So this has brought up a boatload of wowness. I'm feeling it right now. Wow. It's a strain. It's a great strain to do these videos because we're bringing up information that's supposedly taboo and has been so supremely buried. And just unearthing it, you know, is rather amazing. Elation, you know, a lot of wow. Like, wow, I've just finally unearthed that. Wow, I've unearthed that. And of course, every time we do this and then allow the wow to evaporate and dissipate, then we're way further along. You know, we've already done the digging, already uncovered it. And so someone will say, hey, look at that. I said, yeah, I know. I already uncovered that. It's no big deal to me. You know, it doesn't cause much of a wow. Yeah, been there and done that. We're like on this archaeological dig where we keep digging, we keep finding these bones. You know, it's like, oh my gosh, we found this and this and this and this. It's very exciting when you start finding these fossils. But once you've already found them, you know, then someone might say, oh, look at that fossil. You say, yeah, I know, I already unearthed it. Yeah. I've been through the shock of discovery, you know, and the excitement of it all. It's very exciting when you discover something that's been buried and you think that's been lost forever. It's quite exciting. It's kind of cool being certain kind of scientist, you know. I have a lot of respect for scientists, you know, absolutely. The piecing the puzzle, the past together, the way they've done it, you know, is extraordinary. And, you know, the stuff that they're able to do is extraordinary. But I mean, it just is what it is. Yeah, that's all. And they're often wrong, you know, which they'll admit it, you know, but a New World Order cult has been built around science. That's not the way it should be at all. But, yeah, being a scientist and being a detective and trying to discover, you know, how things work and what they are, that's pretty cool. But again, no one can add or subtract one bit from their perfect standing with God. It doesn't matter what we do, it doesn't matter. So I'm not some, you know, anti-science person necessarily. I'm certainly warning people about artificial intelligence. It's very bad. It goes in a very bad way. Continuity fears and control of that. But they're not really scientists. They're roboticists, you know. It's different. Different. There's all different types of scientists, and you know, seem to be less innocuous than others. Hard to believe that summer is going to be gone. Autumn is now here. The autumnal conjunction is now here. And this is when we need to take refuge. Now, one thing we're told is that those who take refuge from the New World Order, they may be, you know, efforts to cut them off from sustenance and all this kind of stuff. However, I believe there is this assurance that whatever is needed will be supplied. whatever is needed will be supplied. So here we just got a box, suddenly just showed a box full of salmon and beef and hamburger patty, just showed up. It's just given to us. Well, there's nothing that can stop, the enlightened ones from supplying anything we need. Nothing can stop them. They can manifest anything at all. They know their perfect standing in God is right now. They know everyone's perfect standing in God is right now. And they're absolutely free. And so whatever is needed out of compassion just happens right now. They can manifest anything at all. If we need food, they can manifest food. If we need houses, they can manifest houses. They can manifest anything. It doesn't take any effort from them at all. It's not some big deal. You can manifest a mountain of diamonds this instant. It's no different than manifesting some hamburger patties to them. No difference. Just appearances. These are just appearances. Just light appearing. Soon they'll be able to print food, but you have to get some sort of, that they're not printing it. You need the raw material to print it, I guess. They're printing, trying to print everything now, but you need the raw material. So they're trying to mimic manifestation. The continuity fear is trying to mimic it, but no, those who are dropped all pretense and accepted the perfect standing of all with God, they can manifest anything. So, water, heat, shelter, food, energy, air conditioning, you name it. And eventually you just take it for granted. Once you get used to that, you just take it for granted. You don't have to think about how is this happening and get spooked by it. No, you just say, okay, of course. This is what we really want. And so we're getting what we really want. This is just assistance. We're getting some help. Just like parents help young children, right? We're like young children who are kind of new upon this path. And so the parents, they're like parents that help us out. You want some food? Do young kids have to supply their own food and health care and energy? And no, they can't do that yet. So the parents supply it for them, right? Parents get the food, cook the food, and give the food to the kids and say, here you go, here's your food. And the kids say, this is good, this is tasty, I like this. So we're used to that. So how difficult are we used to getting some, help? In a similar vein, because we're sort of like children upon this path of salvation, path of repentance, and we're not able to manifest yet. There's too much continuity fear involved in that for us, so. So this is one way of looking at the situation. A lot of people worry, like, how will I get food if I don't go along with the New World Order? How can I survive here? How can I be safe? Well, the truth is that they can actually have cities, and the New World Order can't even see them. Just like the dog, when I said, I am now, the dog couldn't see me, stop barking. Because, see, they only see time. If you're now, they can't see it. They can't see it. They'll overlook it. Because their whole perception is based on overlooking now. So their perception, they'll just won't show it to them. Neither will their instruments. Nothing will show it to them. This is all based on perception and time. So you can still be here in the world in a beautiful city. You could be out in some remote desert or something, and yet it'd be such a beautiful, lush oasis, and they would have no idea that it's even there. And they just might feel they wouldn't be able to travel through it or something. I don't want to go in there. It looks very desolate, very desolate. It feels like a black hole or something to me. I don't want to go there. and nothing could bad could happen there. I mean, this is possible. This is what's possible. I mean, it's possible, like the Sahara Desert, you could have massive cities of those who are on the spiritual path and dwelling there in this gorgeously lush, beautiful oasis, teeming with water and abundant fruits and whatever you need to eat and comfortable living quarters, you know, and they would not even know it's there. They wouldn't even see it. Wouldn't even show up on Google Maps. Not at all. Satellites wouldn't show up. It would just be looked at them like blank desert. And who's to say those places are not already there, as a matter of fact? It's very likely they are. I mean, we talk about a rapture. I mean, there's actually, it's first off, it's not really even necessary to be raptured off this planet. You could just go to one of these beautiful oases that, you know, that's founded on a foundation of nowness by those who have manifested. And you can live there for a while. Absolutely can, as long as you need to. And then at some point you might transfer to a death-free realm. Yeah. So you don't necessarily have to even be raptured off of the planet. And you could interact with people if you wanted to. You could leave the oasis, travel somewhere, and then allow people to see you. You could do that, absolutely. In fact, teachers, great teachers who show up here and let us see their bodies, they make some sort of compensation there so we can even see them, we can even recognize them. But it's easily that if they don't want to be recognized, you can't find them at all. Just like Jesus, they wanted to arrest him so many times, and they couldn't find him. They couldn't see him. He's just walking right through their midst. They couldn't even see him at all. Because he just, you know, was just, he dropped the compensation he was using to be visible. Are noticeable, and they couldn't see him because they're looking in time, space, process, and form. And Jesus is in the now. And in these oases, you wouldn't need any money at all. Everything's free. Everything's just manifested. You want to play golf? There's the golf course. It's free. It doesn't cost anything. Here are the golf balls. Here are the clubs. They're all free. Everything's free. Everything's just manifested. There's no ownership of anything. Your house belongs to you. And it's perfectly acceptable. You don't have any need to say, I want to get another one. So I want to get what somebody else has. Well, if you want the model that like someone else has, then that model will manifest for you. You don't take it away from somebody. You know, there's no buying or selling of anything. The marketplace, the food is there. It's all free. The energy is free. You don't have to. No money's needed at all. There's no stock market. No banks. No identity cards. And, you know, you don't have to carry identity around or anything. No taxes, because there's no maintenance needed. Everything stays flawless as it was manifested to be. Now, everything may be manifested with signs of some wear to it so it doesn't freak us out. This is what I saw, that in the death-free realm, there were some subtle things that were done to make it seem like there was some growth, you know, and stuff. So, but what they would do, they'd manifest an oasis, so it would... The street would show signs of wear. Everything would show some signs of wear. Otherwise, it might freak us out. Say, wait a minute. Whoa, scary. Wait. But if we see a little bit of wear and tear or whatever, oh, you know, okay. Sneeze was trying to hit me there real strong. Wow, I had to use every ounce of my determination to dissipate it. take a supreme effort there. Now, some say, of course, this is like the astral realm, but there's no reason why we can't experience that here on this world. It's just, accept a certain degree of nowness. I am now. I am the nowness. Be willing to go in that direction. I am the nowness. That's the ticket. I mean, that gets you in. It gets you into these places. And they may have some sign of, just like a theme park, or like build these rides in places. And they'll make it like it's like a mining town. They'll build everything intentionally looking old. You know, they make it look old. It's really new, but they make it look old. They distress it. A lot of people these days want distressed stuff in their houses. Everything needs to be distressed, all the wood. Like worms have eaten it, and it's all, they love distress. I mean, they pay tons of money for people to take this brand new wood and just distress the heck out of it. And that's what they do. They bring it to a shop, and they have all these tools. They said that one of the main ones to use are chains. And they just whip the thing, they hit it with chains, and they gouge it with chisels, and they beat it up and distress it intentionally. They bring back the people, and the people say, oh my gosh, this is exactly why, this is wonderful, I love it. That's called, it's very big right now, distressed decor. Distressed decor too. Everything gets looks good. Distressed look, like distressed jeans. You buy jeans. A lot of what do people love? The young people, got to be distressed, pre-washed, pre-ripped, pre-torn. They look like they're almost ready to be thrown away to the trash. You know, they got these out of Salvation Army. These jeans. Look how cool and hip I am. You know, I'm wearing this distressed jeans. Young people seem to love that. They like to say, I'm a migrant. I could play the role. I'm just a migrant here. I'm just staying with my folks for a little while as a migrant. I've not really been here very long. I just kind of just came in on the train. I just hitched a ride on the train, hopped a train, came in yesterday. Shoes are all beat up. My pants are beat up. I've been on the road for a long time. Yeah, I'm just staying with the folks for a little while. That's all. This is the whole thing, you know, that they're playing on. No, I'm free and independent and I travel the world, and I was just coming by my folks' place. I realized, hey, I haven't seen my folks in a while. I think I'll stop in and say hi. Yeah, my hair is all, I had to use a knife to cut it. You know, it's all shaggy and like this, and clothes are all dirty and distressed and stuff. And yeah, I'm a world traveler. I won't be staying here long. This is what they're selling the kids. Most people don't realize that. First time I ever realized it is right now. But this is very clever marketing. Because what do kids want? They want the marketers to tell them, you know, they want an image of independence. I'm independent and resourceful, and I'm a world traveler. I'm not afraid to leave my parents' home. I've been traveling the world. I've been on the road for 2 years. Look how dirty and beat up and torn my clothes are. I got this old T-shirt. You know, I mean, I travel light. Just the clothes on my back, that's all I need, man. I'm so resourceful, I don't even need to bring anything with me. Just got this old torn up T-shirt, these old beat up jeans, and these distressed shoes, and hanging out at the coffee shop here. And, oh yeah, just stopped in to say hi to the folks. Do them a favor, you know, gotta say hi to mom, and just, you know, but after that, I'm going up to Alaska, you know. Who knows where? Could be anywhere. Oh my gosh, you know, these marketers are very clever folks. More clever than we realize. They get us, don't they? They really get us. Hey, I don't like marketers, tell you the truth. Very cynical manipulators. It's easier to like them when you're not getting caught in their snares, right? So we need to accept everybody that has perfect standing with God. So it's better not keep getting caught in their snares, because that makes it more difficult, right? Of course, these kids are driving around in new BMWs, and their parents' BMWs. But that just adds to the cool factor. They say, yeah, you know, I could be driving around this BMW, you know, sure, I could be doing that, but pretty soon I'm gonna, you know, hitch a ride and travel around Russia or something. There. So, isn't that amazing that marketers always market to our insecurities, making us feel, you know, material marketers who do material marketing and give us bogus remedies for it, you know, bogus remedies. It's not, you know, wearing those clothes doesn't make you truly independent or resourceful, right? The Holy Spirit gives you true remedies that really resolve our problems and insecurities. The marketers just milk your insecurities. They don't want you to lose your insecurities. They want to milk your insecurities. We're all just cash cows for them. And of course, you know, a lot of the new age people, they always look like they just got back from Rishikesh, you know, the image or something. You look at it, oh wow, they probably are just were on a like retreat, couple years in India, you know. Wow, they must have really listened to some great gurus there. Must have gotten the Shakti there. Wow. These people are probably, you know, very insecure about their spiritual path and need to, you know, present an image that, like, they're really getting after it. When in fact, you know, they may find it slipping away from them, and so they need to dress the part. Uh-oh, here we go. Here goes the cycle of interruption, right? Which is NWO's, is it? Yeah. there's the interruption, which is fine. Gives you a chance to calm down. It's all good. Everything that happens is for our benefit. You know, just see it in a positive way. Enables us to, you know, give some time, calm down from the wow. Someone's saying, I haven't seen you. I don't know where you are. Are you still okay? Are you still alive? Well, this is the New World Order saying, I can't see you. What happened to you? You know, you're in the now. I can't see the now. Well, then stop looking for time and you'll see the now. I can't do that. I can't do that. Well, because you have a continuity. So own the continuity fear and start working at it. What? Yeah. It's that simple. You know, they're just caught up in the fear, their continuity fear so severely. But that's where they're at. So that's what they have to, where they have to work. They have to work on it there. Nothing else you can say. Nothing else that can be said. I didn't check the temperature, but, you know, it's probably in the mid-90s right now. Maybe going upwards, I don't know. Maybe not. Maybe it'll get 99 a day. It doesn't seem that hot. Not quite like the last heat spell, up to 104. Then you really kind of felt that around 5 o'clock. Take refuge. Time to take refuge. Autumn, we brought up all these issues. There may be a way to take refuge right here in this world, actually. There might be places that, you know, we take refuge, or situations we take refuge in. Possible, or even right where we are, I don't know. But certainly it will become clear to us as we ask for advice on this. You know, how do we take refuge? Let's be honest. The proselytization that is going to take place for the New World Order is going to be ferocious. It's going to be ferocious, and people are going to cut one another off in families, and it's going to be really brutal. What about medicine? And if you take refuge, you'll be able to get medicine. Well, they might have medicines there, sure. If people still need them, why not? They might have better medicines. That you say, this is all in one medicine. Just take this one pill and you'll feel fine. And the placebo effect is so strong there that it works perfectly well for whatever ailments you have. Like most people have ailments, right? Another sneeze. Whew. The sneeze is really trying to get me. Wow. Whoa. Keeps trying to interrupt. So most people have ailments. So you think, oh my gosh, you know, what do I do for my ailments? Well, I'm sure they'll have treatments for that. I mean, situations for that. Probably way more gentle treatments in terms of just drink this water. You know, it's got nice vibration or somehow, and it helps you out. I mean, they'll have whatever mode that people, whatever placebos, it's all placebo. So whatever placebo, everything's placebo. So whatever works even more elegantly and helpful, you'll have there. And you'll probably feel very healthy there, feeling the now, the perfection of the now, our perfect standing. Why should we be sick if we have perfect standing? That's just an expression of fear that we don't have it. So I got to fix it. Yeah, well, I don't have perfect standing. I used to, but I lost it, so I got to fix it. No, we don't have to fix anything. We never lost it. There's nothing that needs to be fixed about our standing with in reality and God and perfect freedom. There's nothing that needs to be fixed, so we don't have to become experts at fixing anything. In fact, we need to drop the whole notion that anything needs to be fixed. How are we doing here? Great. Yeah, it's still going. Oh, wow. Many sneezes have tried to blast me. And that sort of tends to shatter, you know, sneeze away your clarity, so to speak. I don't know what to say to people. I mean, they won't believe, think you're crazy if you talk about stuff like this. Because the continuity fear, they're completely ignorant. They're not able to reason it out. Here we're just reasoning it out. We're following reason. So that sounds reasonable. This sounds very reasonable. This is the time for this. After all, this is the time when the New World Order is going to start proselytizing, uninhibited proselytization. Okay, uninhibited, the meeting of the two beasts is going to promote uninhibited proselytization. And we need to take refuge from this, most definitely. Most definitely, because marketing can be very vicious. They can put the screws to us. And so we'll take whatever refuge you need to take. You know, whether we can be visible or not visible to people. Either way, whatever's effective. You know, it's difficult. All the whining and wheedling and complaining and begging and this. You know, who wants to be subjected to that? I don't want to be subjected to that. I was groveling. Oh, we need you to join because if you don't, we'll be damned too and all this kind of stuff. Because they're really saying is you're the problem. We just got to, you know, if you get you into this, then the problem will be diminished. No, the problem is continuity fear that all of us have. If you're not working on that, you're not doing anything. I don't want to delay. All they're begging for is that you help them delay. I'm not going to help them delay. They're perfectly capable of delaying on their own. If someone wants to delay, they can delay. They don't need people to help them delay. We're not under any obligation to help others delay or go on wild goose chases or anything like that. They'll do it anyway. They just want to make it permanent. They want us to help them make it permanent. Of course, if we try to help them make it permanent, we'll believe that we can make it permanent for ourselves, which will lead us astray, very much astray. Trying to make pretense permanent is the whole goal of the New World Order. And if you buy into that goal and help them, you believe that it's possible to make it permanent. And that'll completely freak out your whole path. You know, you'll disintegrate and collapse. Undermine the whole premise that you need of truth, that we cannot make it permanent. It's impossible, because our perfect standing in God is spirit. It can never be changed. So spirit is the one doing the pretending, and it can never separate from its perfect standing and all-inclusiveness. And so it'll always want to experience that, and so it will never really want to keep pretending. And it will always be in charge of pretending. It never can change. So the goal of making pretending permanent is completely insane. Just hideous delay. It's this pine cone, all of the binding that binds all these pine nuts together in this cone, is it dries out, those loosen up and lose their elasticity or something. Then it basically, once it's all dry, it'll just all fall apart. I'll just hit it and all the pine nuts just go, you know, falling out, disperse, and you just pick them up like that. It's easy. Pretty interesting. It's interesting. I've always wanted to get to an oasis in a desert. My whole life, this has been a fixed goal of mine. I've got to get to that oasis in the desert. Pretty interesting now, hearing this of what can happen here when you're, when it's based on the now, acceptance of the now. Those who are intensely in the time can't even recognize it. They can't even see it. And have a feeling that they want to stay far, far away from you and not get involved at all. Don't get them angry. Don't attack them. No. Stay away, stay away, stay away. It's dangerous, dangerous, dangerous. Like a biohazard site. No, nobody go there. It's radioactive. Terrible. Stay away. Just rationalizations. So we don't know what's really around us and among us and everything. You know, our sight is so incredibly minimalized by our beliefs. Other dimensions, you know, right here, and could be all sorts of stuff going on. I mean, Jesus could be walking down the street and most of the people wouldn't even see him. I might see him, I say, oh, there's Jesus. And people say, see Jesus? I say, what are you talking about? I don't see anybody. You're just pointing to thin air. You're like, I think you're having a psychotic episode or something. I said, no. Jesus is right here. What are you talking about? I'm talking with him right now. No, I don't hear anything. I don't hear anything. This is how continuity, fear, belief in time, space, process, and form, which is pretension, affects our perception. It affects it extremely. They wouldn't even see it. Wouldn't even see the situation. And we have that instances of that all the time where you see something, other people say, I didn't even see that. It's right in front of my face. I didn't even see it. So the perception is very selective. There's some people who see all sorts of stuff and they say, you didn't even see that, did you? No, I didn't even see it. It's true. But that continued. We're missing out on seeing all sorts of situations, all sorts of what we could see. We don't experience it. So, autumn is here. Refuge time is here. This is when the proselytizing of New World Order gets underway. No holds barred. That what they're waiting for, this marketing force is waiting for the official word that they have the authority to go about it, no holds barred, and they will not be prosecuted for it. You know, that is acceptable to the powers that be. You get the pontiff and the president signing off on this, saying, folks, go for it. You know, just like the rioting thugs, you say, hey, you know what, it's the police causing the problem, yeah, go for it, you're within your rights. This is of course they're going to do this, is a, hey, marketing force of the New World Order, do whatever you need to do to bring the flock in here. We gotta get the harvest going here, get everybody on the same page, so however you want to do it, it's okay, go for it. And so they're gonna go for it, and the proselytizing will become extremely intense, and that's what we want to sidestep. This is the desert storm. This is the storm. Could very well be the storm, part of the storm. And they could use false flags like wars and various things to, you know, put people under more stress and pressure. Whatever it takes right now, they'll do it. Big marketing campaign. Biggest marketing campaign in history coming up. You don't want to be in their crosshairs. At this point, the basic outline is important. The details aren't nearly as important as the basic outline. You have to have the basic outline. If you don't have that, you're sunk. It's kind of like there's a ship and there's all these coral reefs and you see where they are and you avoid them. And someone says, well, how deep are those coral reefs? You know, how deep is that one? How deep is that one? How much clearance might you have? I say, I don't care how deep they are. That's the details, unnecessary details. My job is to avoid the coral reefs, and I'm just staying in deep water. I'm fine. You don't need those kind of details in order to navigate successfully. You can, you know, over get too much data. It's easy to get too much data. In fact, you might say the whole world is swamped in too much data. People are data addicts. If you want to avoid something, just as enough, you avoid it, you avoid it. That's the goal, not how much data can you get out of the avoidance. You know, avoid it. You get these idiots who think they have to collect like infinite amounts of data, and they forget about, they lose sight of the forest because they're off of the trees. They end up getting clobbers. Oh, but I was trying to collect data. I just for loss, you know, boom. Stupid. You see a cat in the road you're driving, you swerve around it. You don't say, how far is that cat into the road? How many steps has it taken? How close is my car? What is the speed of my car traveling? You know, what is the distance between me, the car, and the cat? How long will it take me to hit the cat? No, you swerve around it. You just instantly swerve, get around it. And these idiots think that they're somehow robotic data collectors. You know, I'm not a robot. We're not robotic data collectors. This is extreme stupidity. If there's any data to assess, you know, we'll assess it later. Meanwhile, we'll get out of harm's way first, and then deal with the data later. These idiots put data first and get out of harm's way later. You couldn't have things more in a backwards, upside down backwards situation. That's what concerns me, is this attitude people have, is that you're supposed to be collecting data. You're not supposed to be getting out of harm's way. That's what's more important, to get the data. And that you're wrong or bad if you don't get data on something. I feel like this is a big problem. For me, it tends to hook me somewhat, you know. It's so stupid that it tends to hook us. And I say, well, you need to sacrifice yourself for future generations. No, because if I live, I'll be able to inform future generations how to sidestep stuff better. And so they'll be wise, and they'll be able to sidestep even better than I am. So they won't even need to worry about all this data collection. What they're really saying is, we need to make pretending permanent, you know, so we need to distract ourselves from truth as much as possible. So collecting data is a great way to distract ourselves. So you need to buy into this agenda of just, you know, never-ending data collection. Completely lose sight of the forest because you're obsessed with the trees. So they want to pull you into their obsession, their data collecting obsession. So we ask Jesus to put his foot down on this, and all those who have dropped pretense entirely and accepted the perfect standing of all in reality, to put their foot down, put their feet down, and give us refuge, provide the refuge that we ask for and deserve and have prepared for, so we do not have to keep dealing with this madness here in the world. So and this campaign that's going to get underway. It's going to get underway. Got every right to sidestep a toxic marketing campaign, which is what they're really saying, is that you have to accept the goal of trying to make pretense permanent. That's what they're really after, and this is, you know, completely opposite of truth, absolutely insane, and involves endless misery and suffering. So if we don't have a right to say no to that, we don't have a right to say no to anything. This is a fact. If they claim, no, you can't say no to that, what they're saying is you have no right to say no to anything, which is like total slavery, opposite of freedom. I mean, remember, freedom is the freedom to say, I want to experience this, which also saying, no, I don't want to experience that right now. I want to experience this. So it's both yes and no. Reality is both yes and no. So of course we have right to say no to this marketing campaign. We're absolutely free to do that. We're not slaves. That's just delaying. Acting as a slave is just more pretense, more delaying. And of course they don't see this at all. So we need some help. I'd greatly prefer some help now, for sure. It's a very tough marketing campaign. Brutal marketing campaign. Where are we at? We're almost at the end of this. Yeah. And they don't play fair at all. They think anything goes, anything is fair, because they've gotten the go-ahead by the two beasts. So they think they're on the side of righteousness and God and all that is holy and right and to save the planet, which really means to try to make pretense permanent. That's what they won't say it, but that actually is the goal. To automate it, to make it permanent. So they think, therefore, there is no continuity fear because I don't have to drop pretense. This is what the continuity fear says is the cure. Permanent pretense, never have to drop it. It's automatic, will never stop. Therefore, no more continuity fear. And this is impossible. It doesn't work. It's not a matter we have to go down the road to see how it works. It's seen from the very beginning. It's completely clear. It's totally impossible. We don't have to go down any road to find out that it's impossible. Reason will show us clearly it's obviously completely impossible, not the slightest possibility that could ever work. You can see it at any point upon the road. At any point upon the road, you can see this fact. Reason can show you this, and you say, wow, I just need the now. I don't need time-space process form at all. I never needed to go down that road. I could have just recognized that it's inherently impossible. We can never separate the pretender from the pretense. It's impossible. And the pretender is spirit, which has perfect standing with God. That can never change. So the pretending that it can change can never happen. So I'll never be satisfied. And it never... the pretense never leaves the pretender, so the dissatisfied pretender is going to drop the pretense for sure. For sure. No choice in the matter. No choice in the matter whatsoever. Okay, so we're getting pretty close to the end here, and I got no choice in this. When it hits the end, that's it. It hits the end. So I'm trying to give it everything I got, trying to help as much as possible, and clarify. We've asked for help with Refuge. Let it be so. I can, I will, I've already got it. I can get it, I will get it, I've already got it. I can get help, I will get help, I've already got the help. I can get help, I will get help, I've already got the help. We just want our protection from this marketing campaign, which is trying to keep us from realizing that we can realize the truth. Look at reason right now and see that truth is true right now. We don't need to go down any road at all. It's totally without, you know, it's delusional. The continuity fears road is completely futile. See that right now. We don't have to try it out and see how it goes. We know it's impossible from the very beginning. And to try it out is doing a disservice to everybody. It's saying, well, maybe it is possible. That's doing a disservice to everyone. How are we doing? Oh, it's going extra time here. Is that we're actually getting the full time here? That's nice. That's very good. Okay, so this is enough. This is a lot to digest here. Big meal.